that want to borrow it and then we should flood it.
Yeah, yeah.
So he's got to sort of beat them off before he even has a chance of a go at the Tories. So it's going to be quite an interesting development. But yeah, it's just nice to see that kind of popular groundswell.
Mm.
Okay, are we all set?
Yeah.
Cool. Did you pour Adam his wine?
Yes, it's just in that black cup there.
I'm still going to get the one wine glass, haven't
you? Yeah. Maybe do something.
I'm
like
not
that.
You're on film, so
okay. Section is titled The Dual Character of Labour Embodied in Commodities. So, who wants to have a go and tell me what they made out of it, or what they don't make out of it, or whatever? Who's got something to say? Not
Brooklyn, no! No!
We started getting onto last time, and we talked about use and exchange value, which are both embedded in the commodity.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, yep, that's really good, mate. That's really good. Blair?
Me?
You want to throw something in?
I can't deal with this. Come here. Just now I've got a face around the backyard. I can't look outside. So the whole thing about labour, socialist necessary labour time, there was a school of Marxism called the analytical Marxists, and they basically thought that socially necessary labour time was just the average time it took to make something. That's not how it works.
No,
it's a dialectical idea. It's about actualising some sort of socially necessary concept. It's about a practical example. I literally can't catch it. This is really embarrassing because my neighbours are going to come over and yell at me in about 5 minutes. Do not yell at me. Just be very condescending.
You want to get her into the laundry?
Yeah, I...
Have you got some food to wait?
I just gave her a little pig trot and
maybe...
You're
going to take it in there and try to affect her attention that way.
She's going to bark in the laundry then maybe, but she knows that she has to keep quiet in the laundry.
Come here. I've got her.
Okay.
You want a cup to grab it?
She's just excited. There's someone small about her size and all the play.
She's here. She's very scared of Cedric's son for some reason.
You got it?
Let's go. Thanks, Charmaine. So, in Hegel, there's this really weird idea called the concept. And the concept is meant to be the essence of something.
Yep.
And the essence of something is kind of what is like what the intrinsic value of something is. And so when something matches up to its concept, that's when it's good, and that's when something is actualized and becomes real. And so this is what socially necessary labor time is meant to be. And so this is like, it's taken years to understand this, because the labor theory of value is the rational humanistic kernel inside capital, inside Marxism. And as soon as you get rid of the labour theory of value, you kind of get rid of the whole purpose of having a revolution and trying to save humanity entirely. Because the whole idea behind that comes later is commodity fetishism, and that's when you have alienated labour. And it's also like a profoundly ethical thing inside of Marx's 1844 manuscripts. And like, I've only just realised this by saying this. But a really important, it's a very difficult concept, and it's probably not one you're going to master for a long time. It took me a long time to master.
Cool.
But it's a profoundly Hegelian idea. Socially necessary labour time is not the average time, Because if it was the average time, it would only work retrospectively. You would only know whether the socially necessary labour time would work by adding up all the things in your funding and then going backwards. You wouldn't be able to know prospectively in the future. And so by using Hegelian dialectics and the idea of the concept, this is what allows the labour theory value to work. Or the whole idea of exchange value versus use value. This is, this is my little contribution.
Yep, that's good. Okay, so yep. Good, that's good. Okay, so yeah. So as Marx says, the commodity, it's just last fortnight, has got two things. It's got a use value. Anything that is made has to have a use value, otherwise it's useless. Someone's got to be able to do something with it. If you have something you've made, which absolutely nobody in the world has any whatsoever use for, it's nothing, okay? Now, if you sum up all the use values in a given society, you've got a measure of the actual material wealth of that society. Important point, because we tend to think of wealth in terms of money values. Marx is saying the actual material wealth of a society is the total sum of use values. Everything going around that has a use. Now, what has a use is going to vary from time to time and place to place. There's no set standard, there's no benchmark, there's no universality to it. Every place, every time is going to have use for some things and not for others. So even, you know, we have discarded stuff into a tip. People are still going there taking things out to recycle, reform. It's not necessarily got no use value. It's got a different use value when it's reshaped into something else. That may still be a use value, even though it's been discarded by 90% of the population. Everything's are usefully added up to material value. Now, use values generally are made by people, but not always. Nature produces use values too. Things grow. The soil can be used to grow things, water, air we breathe. These are all naturally provided use values. So it's not solely made by people. There's also a natural component in use values. Okay, now as we discussed last time, once you start getting a universe of use values, people have to do swapsies. Because they're going to have different use values in their possession. And that's where you start working out, how do we work out the relationship between that cup and this book? I've got a book, I want the cup, he wants the book. How do we feel we're getting a fair value out of it? So we develop this idea of an exchange value. And it might be we say, well, okay, Blair and I might venture up an agreement. Yeah, okay, fine. Two books for one cup. So I've got to find another book that he wants that I no longer want, and we come to an agreement on that one and we exchange it over. Now, as the last section, just recapping this a bit, in the last section what Marx talked about was what is actually being exchanged when we say two books for one cup? Because they're quite different things. What are we actually exchanging? And he says, well, if we actually reduce it down, the only thing that we can identify that things have got in common is they've been made. Human activity has been spent in them. Labour has been spent in them. So we're obviously exchanging labour. But this can't just be... But the labour is different, because the labour involved in typesetting a book, printing it, binding it, and the labour involved in casting it. How do you compare those tasks? They are totally different tasks. They require different knowledges, different dexterities, different skills. How do you compare? They are totally disparate. How do you compare them? Ah, well, maybe it's the time. But he said, that doesn't actually work either, because logically that would mean the product made by the stupidest, slowest, dumbest, most incompetent worker would always be worth the most exchange value, because five times as much time has gone into making that so it can't be that. It has to be a form of average labour. And basically it comes down once again to a time and place thing. At a particular time, in a particular place, on average, on an average level of skill and knowledge, how long would it take a person to make that? So we actually are exchanging a very abstract concept, and he calls it socially necessary labour time. Now, this is quite important because, again, socially necessary labour time, or SNLT as the economists use the abbreviation, again, isn't fixed, even in a social time and place, because This year, the exchange will be two books for a cup. But within 12 months, they've revolutionized the way of making cups. And the time it took to make one cup 12 months ago, they are making 8 cups. So the value of that compared to the book, in other words, the social history labor time embedded in that is actually reduced. It's 1/8 of what it used to be. So I'm sorry, it's not two books anymore. I know you had the cup there for a year, you've been trying to move it on, and when you made it, it was worth two books, but now it's not. Because it's an 8. So what I'll do is I'll tear the last 30 pages off and give you those, okay? that's about the equivalent. Okay, because that gets to a very different time and place as well, and over time, so it's not a fixed thing. But that's the only abstract thing that can be, so we end up calling it abstract. It's abstract labour. It's abstract labour. It's not real specific tasks. It's been abstracted into the thing. So now we're talking about how this labour operates within the commodity in this section. Yes? Yes.
I get all that, but it still comes down to how you measure socially necessary labour time. Because you can, obviously there's a clear, you're saying, oh, that's what we're assessing on. The measurement comes out in what you're willing to exchange, like making a judgement. But separate from that exchange, how do you...
Okay. There isn't a formula. There isn't a formula either here or in real life. But it is, logically, the only thing there is. Otherwise, what do you do?
Yeah, and I realise it's probably going to come along, it probably gets down into better understanding commodities.
Yeah.
Because obviously the next thing that comes to mind is, well, we know that things that actually have been to make really, really cheaply and really quickly can still actually be remarkably expensive.
Right. Because that's a price. And price and value are not pursued the same thing.
Yeah, I suppose what I was going through is all that exchange value, though, what you'd be willing to exchange more than just price.
Yep. You're jumping a lot of steps.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, yeah. But you are starting to think, you're thinking about this, hang on, what's the problem with this argument, which is good. Because you're looking out for the answer as you go, which is great. Yeah. Okay. That's good. I don't want to jump too far
with my
answer.
That's
good. Keep that thought there for the next few sessions. So what have we got? So he's making the point that this really is postulates quite a sophisticated social system. It's based upon a division of labour. To have specialised tasks, which can only be compared by abstracting them, implies quite a complex division of labour. It implies that tailors and weavers and shoemakers and bookbinders and printers already are different skills, different trades, different tasks, different ensembles of knowledge. So we already are, inherent in all this is not an historical account. You've got to understand, he's not actually making an historical account going from a very simple society. It's actually a logical account. Okay, so he's discussing capital in chapter one. That's why I just say abstract, in terms of the logic of the commodity, how it works in a rational analysis. He's not trying to analyze an historical sequence. And a lot of people in the past, or on readings, have got mixed up and have assumed this is some kind of history. And then gone, well, where do we find this in history? You're going to find it's not actually about an historical sequence. It's about a thing. So to actually have a social history labor time, it really assumes a division of labor, which assumes, of course, a fairly complex social structure. So as he says, men made clothes for thousands of years because they needed clothing, but it didn't turn somebody into a tailor. A tailor is actually something quite separate. A tailor is a specialised person who just makes clothing, not the guy who says, oh, I've killed a bear, I've got to stick some pants over it. It's quite separate from just making clothes, yes.
I'm trying to remember the point of like socially necessary labour time doesn't require division of labour. I mean, it requires division of labour, but not the inverse. Like,
it, not the inverse, yeah.
So what does he mean?
Aha, yeah. Okay, I'm going to send the quote out. The division of labour is a necessary condition for commodity production.
Yeah.
Like you're making things that can be exchanged. The converse does not hold. Commodity production is not a necessary condition for the social division of labour. They say you can have a social division of labour without making commodities. Commodity, at the end of the day, always contains a use value and an exchange value. Bear that in mind. A commodity always contains both. If it doesn't contain an exchange value, it's only a thing you use. It's not a commodity. Okay? So you can have a division of labour that doesn't make commodities. So what he's doing here is actually already suggesting a whole different way of organising society that is not based on exchange of value. Yeah, I mean, I can see that the brain is now reeling because, whoa, where's this going? Remember I said beforehand, one of the things, and the book I'm going to refer to later on, one of the things that enables Marx to actually critique political economy is he has a conception of a world which is different. And without that standing, and as someone else just said, without that standpoint, you cannot do it. If you just try and critique political economy from within the established way of thinking, you'll never get there. Because you're caught in, over and over again, the vocabulary, the concepts, the thought patterns just go round and round and round. You've got to be able to somehow step outside. And this is why this is such hard work, the first chapter or so, for people reading it, because where is he coming from? He has a perception already outside. He has a perception of a social system. Not primitive, not caveman, advanced, technologically skilled, educated, like us. Or perhaps even more so. With all the complexities and sophistication of our society that we have. But that doesn't require commodities. It doesn't require exchange. Now, obviously the mechanics of how that kind of world would work, he doesn't spell out because none of us know it. As he says elsewhere, I can't write recipes for the kitchens of the future. People at the time have to work out how to make their own bread. You know, people at the time have to work out how to resolve these issues. But you can theoretically conceive of a world, it's just what he can, where we aren't dependent upon an exchange of value, where value actually vanishes. We're just making stuff we need, and we're sharing it out. In other words, a world where we sit down and say, okay, for a good laugh, what do we need, and how many of them? Great. How much work is involved in making that? We'll share that work around people. Those that can do this, but do that. Those that can do that, do that, do that, do that. At the end of the day, we've got the pile of stuff we need, everyone gets what they need. That's it. Simple. It still involves a sophisticated, highly technological, educated division of labour, but it isn't involved the transmission of calculating and exchange. Okay? So that's what this is getting at here.
Because this is what has ultimately drawn me to Marx.
Yep.
And the socialism in general. Because I suppose, and I know this obviously isn't exactly what exists in capitalist society anyway, but just where the thought first came to my head, I think, as a kid, was were things like sports clubs and public libraries. Because that's exactly what happened. People went, well, we need this. And anyone that joins, like, oh, well, if you need to play sport, then we need to create a team for it. You know, and now we've got too many, so we have to create another team. Like, that's just how it existed. And I remember as a kid just seeing that and going, well, actually, why isn't everything like this? It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
And same with libraries. So I can go in and just take what I need, and then I don't need any more.
Well, you've got a card, and you can take it. You just take it back. Yeah, you know, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And if my wife gets a book. Yeah. So there's this concept there, that's where that statement comes into it. He's already jumping in. Okay, here's an interesting point. Labour is a condition of human existence. It is an eternal natural necessity. Labour is an eternal natural necessity which mediates the metabolism between man and nature and therefore human life itself. What's the big words? But very important, because metabolism is a term he comes up with over and over again. And he often uses the metabolism. To him, that's a biological thing. He's basically saying, if you think about this, you know, for 1860, it's actually a very advanced ecological concept. Humans and the natural world exist together in symbiosis. humans cannot exist away from the natural world. Humans have never been able to exist away from the natural world. Humans are part of nature, but at the same time humans change nature. And nature changes humans. This is before Darwin, basically, you know, so we are in some quite incredibly complex and advanced ideas embedded in this very brief idea of a metabolism. But he's saying the way that interaction works is it requires people to do something. Unlike a lion, which jumps from an animal and eats it straight out. All the tools are part of his body. The teeth, the claws, the digestive system, it's all there. Okay, a herbivore walks around chomping grass. Boom, 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 boom. All he uses his teeth and his guts, and he's alive. Humans don't quite work like that. Firstly, we haven't got tools as part of our body, generally. Very few things we can actually process without some kind of additional tool. And very often also in the raw form, the things we take out of an animal, very basic here, the food take of nature, often we can't eat. We have to do something else to it. Cook it, macerate it, mash it up, butcher it, grind it. Because we haven't got that direct connection. We actually have to post, we have to labor. Okay? We have to work. Human existence depends upon humans doing something. So it is labor that regulates this metabolism, this interaction. So for Marx, the idea of doing labor is actually what humans are all about. It's human activity. It's human essence. It's our species existence. We have to do stuff. Otherwise we simply don't live. And it's the doing of this that is the point at which us and the rest of the world interface, interact, and feed off each other. And he calls that a metabolism. Stressing is a bit because it'll turn up later on, because later on in the book he talks about metabolic rift as a consequence of capitalist development, where that connection gets broken down, and he, particularly in regard to agriculture, he discusses this. Because what you have, the population moves into the cities, fertility is taken out of the soil in terms of food, people eat it, and rather than the waste product going back into the soil, it gets shut out down a sewer system out to sea, and the soil gets depleted. It's not getting the nutrient put back into it, that the metabolism breaks down and it causes a metabolic rift. And it's, if you know, there's a whole school of thought, James Burney Foster and so on, like you have in the States, but develops a whole ecological meaning of Marx out of this. Because he's essentially talking about that breakdown that urbanization and concentration of population produces. So that's why I stress that, you know, the expression is metabolism, but it comes up quite often again. So yeah, so use values combine two things, natural materials and labor. We take things from nature, we process them, and we make something out of it. You grow grain, you turn it into flour to make bread, or pasta, or whatever else. You catch animals, you process the skins, shoe leather, fur, wool from the sheep, whatever else. We have to do stuff. So every use value combines in some proportion or other natural material and human activity, human labor. So he's basically going over and reinforcing the point about average labour. Okay, so you know, so the examples of tailoring and weaving are quite different activities, but they are both an expenditure of human energy. Okay, in this sense they are both human labour. So average labour, abstract labour, is ignoring all that specialised kind of specialized skill and knowledge that each individual activity requires. It's just saying, yeah, okay, fine. What they have in common, once again, bookbinding, shoemaking, tailoring, what they have in common is they all involve an expenditure of human energy, of human life force, if you like. You know, they involve muscular activity, they involve thought, they involve the whole, you know, human energy. Human energy. Important to bear in mind, and keep remembering this, that when you work, when you do something, you're expending your energy. And if there is a point, even in a non-capitalist society, where exchange is an issue, it is the issue of what are you getting back for your energy. Which we'll come to this a little later on too, when we start discussing the mechanics of the working day. And how much of the working day are you actually paying for? And how much of the working day is in fact the employer taking your energy from you?
question. So he talks about this. I was speaking to a mate of mine, and he mentioned also like kind of cooperative labour, that's labour that the employer gets for free. So say like me and Blair work in a company, you know, the kind of joint effort by us is like labour that is not accounted for within.
There's a whole bunch of things that aren't accounted for. Okay, a whole bunch of stuff. And there's whole sections, you know, we get a lot more detail later on. But the core of it basically is, at the end of the day, and I'm going to jump in quite a lot of way ahead here, what he ends up, this agonizing step-by-step process doing, is showing us that when we go into the marketplace under the capitalist system to get a job, we are selling our average or abstract labor power. The employer is buying for that price, which is the socially agreed value of the commodity of labor. In other words, when you go to go and offer yourself to an employer, you are selling your energy as a commodity in exchange for a market price. If you then compare how much you actually produce in the course of the time that market price covers, you'll find there's quite a discrepancy between what you turn out, i.e. how much of your life energy, your physical energy, your mental energy you spend, how much you get back. And that is the secret of capital. Because you aren't being paid what you produce.
Although I think in my case, I'm one unproductive worker, so I reckon I probably get it all back, but you know, for the most part, yeah.
But yeah, but basically that's what it comes down to, that you don't. So in other words, what the wage relationship, and I've shot chapters ahead here, what the wage relationship ultimately does is steal your life. Mm. Steal your energy. Steal your physical capacity. And turn it into something somebody else can sell and make money out of. That is the secret of capital. Mm.
I think of the concept of like something that a lot of people intuitively understand.
Anyone who works
for
a living, possibly not always in white collar positions because it's a bit more masked by what you do, but anyone who actually works for a living where they're actually doing something knows this. The example I give people who argue with me, and it's happened quite often, is say, look, I'm a cook. I walk into the kitchen in the morning. And it's all nice and clean, there's lots of sharp knives, there's an oven, there's a pizza oven, there's a rolling pin, all kinds of lovely stuff there. Fridges full of stuff, material, all this equipment. And I can stand at the door all day long and look at it. And guess how much pizza comes out of the oven? One round number. No pizza comes out of that oven until I do something. And at the end of the day, I get my $120, but when I tally up the sales, $400 or whatever. Okay, yeah, there's a bit of wear and tear from the machinery, there's a cost of material, if I can add it onto it, there's probably still $300 left over. That wasn't there before. And it didn't happen until I made pizza. It didn't happen until I made pizza. But I've only got $120. And anyone who's actually involved will instinctively say no. You know, any person, a bricklayer, boilermaker, tradesperson of any kind, yeah, they all know that. They all know that. instinctively. It gets a bit masked when you get involved perhaps in professional work or white collar work. It's very hard to measure what the product is. But, yes.
Yeah, well, I don't think it's too, I mean, you know, working in Hazard, I think it's quite stark actually that we're, in one way or another, we are producing far more than what we're ever, certainly ever getting back, I mean, than what we're paid for in our labour. And that, I mean, that's probably not just because it's so little comparatively that you just kind of go, this couldn't get much lower. Yeah. The whole effort's been getting cheaper.
Okay, so it's basically because any task involves expenditure of human energy, we basically, that's what we're talking about, it's simple labour. And even more complicated in things are really just more intensified or increased cooperative, multiplied bits of simple labour. Yep.
Just the general commentary around what you get out of that 400, would be that people would argue that, well, the 100 is your labour, but then the others is the cost of the knives.
I can add and go the $80 maximum.
Yeah.
Because a knife isn't used in one day. The knife costs $50, and it's used for 3 years.
Yeah, and I'm just going to.
The oven costs $800, and it's used for 10 years.
Yeah, and I'm just going to keep playing this because. Yeah. It's equipping me to have these.
You've got to do it. Because are you here? Yeah, sure. But that bit of equipment is not used in one hit. It doesn't make one piece of pizza.
Yeah.
That oven will make 20,000 pieces of pizza. So the price of the oven is divided by 20,000. Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay, it's not that much. That machine might cost $50,000, but it's going to make 20 million widgets.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's the value per widget? 3 or 4 cents.
And some would also argue that the profit, which then goes back, makes its way back to the boss, or to the owner, they would argue all of the labour and energy they've invested in actually...
Really?
Getting
I don't see them making any pizza at all.
No, but setting it, the fact that they've set about getting the contractors, making the calls, getting the business set up, blah blah blah,
advertising to market into it. That's easy.
Yeah,
that's
what I mean. But I'd say all that time that it took them, the hours it spent to actually go through the process of setting up this business, that profit is. So you're getting from the bit for your labour you put in, and it's only in that profit that they get back.
Okay,
to
fine. All the administration, that's a product. Yeah. Okay, fine. If you pay a manager, do it. Another $100 a day, wouldn't it? Or $200 a day.
Yeah.
Well, there's still money left over.
But this is where I think for some reason people are okay with. They're like, yeah, but they set it up. So they
because they've been socially educated to believe that there is some kind of special entitlement to that. The answer is that entitlement exists because we have a private property regime. The only reason that entitlement exists is because we have a concept of private property. This belongs to you, therefore you can have this out of it, even though if we add it up at the end of the day, you've got nothing for it.
Yeah. And
then we've been set this business without something. Yeah. So, where does that come from? That's where we start at the back of the book.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's where it comes from there. When you drive people away, historically, from being able to feed themselves or produce themselves, so they have to go into the marketplace and sell their labour power as a commodity.
Mm.
Okay? And as we go further in and come to this thing, we'll start to realise that the wage, the price of your commodity labour power, is simply a market determined. Basically, it's the cost of reproducing you as a human being. That's what it is. It's the cost of reproducing you as a human being. It doesn't bear much relation to what you actually do with it.
Mm.
Okay? But you'll be equipped for those things, but yeah, it's a starting point. It's a good starting point. Okay, so we're talking about, he's making the point here that what we're aggregating into here is a form of simple labour. Simple average labour. Okay, you discovered material wealth already. Increase the Okay, the concluding paragraph of the section. On the one hand, all labour is an expenditure of human labour power in the physiological sense. And it is this quality of being equal or abstract human labour that it forms the value of commodities. Now, there's a footnote here where he says nothing of this has to do with wages. We are not at this stage discussing it. This stage of representation, footnote 15 on page 135. At this stage of representation, the category of wages does not exist at all. So don't let it confuse your thinking. I've used it as an example, but he's talking here about a concept called value, which is just, it's not a quantitative thing, it's what we produce. It's the social value of the simple labour time we have spent in producing that. Okay, so the quality of being equal or abstract human labour, that it forms the value of commodities. On the other hand, all labour is an expenditure of human power in a particular form and with a definite aim. And it's this quality of being concrete that it produces use values. He keeps hammering this. So you go in there, you do a job. You both do it as a specific, unique bundle of skills which produces a useful object. But at the same time as doing that, you are also doing it as a simple average labour which produces a value which can be measured and exchanged and worked on. So when you go and it sounds like, yeah, okay, fine, so what? But it's a classic dialectical thing to break something down and then combine it differently and see where it comes out. So when you go in there and you know, I make my pizza. I'm doing a specific trained exercise as a cook to make pizza. I'm making something useful, it's yummy, and it feeds people, and fills up their tummies and keeps them going for the day. Or curry or whatever else I'm cooking that day. So that's my specific, I'm doing that. But at the same time in doing that, I'm also expending simple average labour, which can be sort of quantified into the product and used to be exchanged for something else. So if we exchange the pizza for a pair of shoes, although that person wants the pizza to fill their stomach, we aren't exchanging the stomach fillability of the pizza. We're exchanging the simple average labour power. So it might well be pair of shoes, that's 20 pizzas. That's, you know, an hour and a half, whatever amount of effort I've left. That's 20 pizzas for a pair of shoes. There's no way a person's going to eat 20 pizzas. That's way beyond their use value need. But it's the only way the simple average labour embodied in the pizza is going to equal the simple average labour embodied in making a pair of shoes. For that exchange value, the exchange value doesn't necessarily, you know, what makes the exchange happen is the use for it. But 20 pizzas is more than his stomach fillability capacity can take. He only needs one, maybe one and a half, he's a big guy. Maybe two if he's Andre. But 20 is way more than he can ever do. But it's the only way he's going to get an equivalent of the labour power spent on the shoes. So that's why there's two things happening at once. Two things happening at once. And I know this was like, yeah, okay, why is this important? What's this important? But as we go on, you'll start to see why it's important.
But it's so just showing that abstract, that
yeah.
Socially necessary.
It is. It's totally abstract. Now, Adam made a wonderful point last fortnight when he said, if we look at modern work, where the ethos of employment is, you need to be good at your job, but you need to be infinitely flexible and go into a different job if you need to. You're not going to have a career as XYZ anymore. You're going to have multiple careers. You're going to shift around. What we're actually seeing here is the forcing of specific qualitative skilled labour into abstract labour. You're actually seeing it in real life under the conditions we work under now. The expectation is that you won't tie yourself to one set of skills. That in fact most jobs are broken down. It's a brilliant book. It's quite old now, but it's still brilliant. Harry Braverman, Braveman. And it's called Labour and Monopoly Capital. And you'll find a PDF, definitely a PDF on the internet somewhere. The opinion. I read before I even read this stuff. And that was really, what Harry Braverman does is study how labour had changed between 1900 and the 1970s. And the start of the century, you tended to have skilled craftsmen who controlled what they did. And he used example of shipbuilding, because that's what his training was. He was a shipbuilder, a metal worker in a shipyard. That's what he initially trained as before he became a writer and a socialist editor and so on. Interesting guy, real organic intellectual. But he said, now, you know, we measured up the quantities, we cut the metal, we controlled that. We exercised a full panoply of skills. You go into a shipyard in the 70s, you feed into a machine. It chops it off. Another guy holds it up, another guy puts three rivets, another guy welds it on. That job that was done by a craftsman is now broken down into components done by 12, 13, 14, 15 different people. None of whom need any specialised training. They need a 3-hour induction or not to get their fingers stuck in the machine. It can be done by a guy with virtually no education because it's abstracted. And when that job runs to an end, he can go and get a job in a brick factory, pressing a button on the machine to make bricks.
Yeah.
Or whatever else.
So what?
I'm pointing out that's...
There's two questions.
I'm going to take the first I'm going to say it's not a problem in the sense that what I'm using the example for in this case is simply to show that this abstraction actually gets turned into reality. One of the interesting things in studying capitalism through the prism of Marx is he models up an abstract model, but we can actually see the abstraction becoming real. We can actually see that capitalism actually is a very abstract symptom. Now that's what I'm trying to come to your comment, coming back to your comment. It's a very abstract system. It actually takes things and makes them abstract. Other analysts talk about being symbolic. That's quite a trendy thing in certain postmodernist circles and things like that. It means much the same thing. Things aren't what they actually are. They deal in symbols and in abstractions. Capitalism. Think of the world financial markets. Okay? I spent years working in merchant banking, and I remember going over to Sydney to one of the big fund managers, Advanced Bank it was back in worth money, 94, to do an investigation, a study of how they manage their money and you know stuff like that. And they very proudly took me out to one of the floors in their office. They said, all these guys have these computers here. They've all got PhDs, some of them got 2 PhDs. He's an astrophysicist. He's a medical researcher. He's got a PhD in medical research. They get all these brilliant scientific qualifications. What are they doing? Well, they're making us money. What are they doing? They're doing sort of formulas, derivative stuff, you know, they do complicated. What are they doing? No idea. No idea what they're doing, but it makes us money. And basically what it comes down to, what these people do, is essentially go to you and say, I've got a mathematical formula which says that if you give me the money and we do that, you'll get that. I'm not going to give you anything, not even a piece of paper, not even a share certificate. You are buying a faith in my formula. And that, the bottom line, creates Beer's market crash. These pyramids of fictitious symbolic value, broken down to other bits, and other bits built upon them. A mortgage is a concrete thing. I go to the bank, I borrow money to buy a house. But then what happens is that mortgage, the bank says, well, we actually don't want the risk of you defaulting on us. So we're going to actually sell rights to that mortgage in 5% lots to 100 other people. And they're going to do something else with that little bit of piece. This one concrete mortgage becomes abstracted out into this universe and multiplied in value. $100,000 mortgage is multiplied out into a $10 million pyramid, reverse pyramid of fictitious values. And when it falls over, the whole world falls apart. When it falls over, the whole world goes to pieces. But it's purely abstract.
And this is why I'm emphasising the labour thing as well, because, you know, it's, as your point is, that, yeah, it's a terribly abstract thing. But the fascinating thing about capitalism is it actually makes the abstract real. It actually works on the abstraction. And that's why Marx often talked about later on as an inverted society. In human society, and he uses later on the image of the sorcerer's apprentice, you know, the broom going out of control. This is what we invent, things like money and so on, like that, exchanges, to make life easier for us. But then it comes to owners. And the whole logic is turned upside down. Rather than us controlling our inventions, our mechanisms, they control us. Because they want to get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. All of this grow up like a cancer cell. That's when we get bigger and bigger. And we have to do stuff to make it get bigger. And all this abstraction gets pushed. So that's the first point. It's not saying it's a bad, it's how it is when we create abstraction. Why is it a bad thing? Well, I don't know that moralistic term. What it enables, of course, is a much greater making of money out of it. Because where you had one tradesman, you now have 12 people producing a much greater output than he did on much lower rates of pay. So at the simplest value, what it does is enable the accumulation of capital on an ever greater scale by someone up the line.
And far more replaceable.
And people are far more replaceable. Yes.
Don't need anyone
having skills. Well, don't you have a apprenticeship anymore?
Yeah. I was a bit lost now after I've had some of the state where they all just feel like, oh,
that's a problem. Part of the problem is there's more, isn't there? You're looking for a problem, you're looking for something wrong. That's not the issue. It's not about morality. That's how it is. That's how the world works. Is it rational? Does it improve our quality of life? What does it do? What's the outcome? What does it achieve at the end of the day? 12 people hating what they do for 10 hours a day, 48 weeks a year. Surrendering their life energy, not even getting the full value of it back. Being used up so someone else can make money. Is that a bad thing? It's an irrational thing.
I also think like a reduction in people's potential.
Yes.
Like a deliberate taking away of people's.
Yep. And again, very, very good observation. Very astute. Because one thing we can't go further, Marx is really big on, is the idea of a different world. Is where he's a famous quote in one of his books where he says, where the full development of each is contingent upon the full development of all. Marx's ideal, if you like, that's the word, his utopia, if you have that in mind, is a world where everyone can achieve and work towards their maximum capacity as human creative. He's got this great idea of people as incredibly talented, incredibly creative, incredibly intelligent, incredibly capable people. And entities that can. Marx sees them can all be gods. That's where it comes down. He sees them can all be gods. We all have enormous potential. We all have enormous. But exactly as he said, it's reduced down. It's reduced down. It's chopped down to you pull this lever for 10 hours a day. 5 days a week, 48 weeks a year. When you're 65, you can stop. No, I don't know anything else that I call a bloody leader. What else do I know? Bet on some horses and drink some beer. And it starts there, at school. With the idea that you've got talents, that there are things you can do. You're no good at math. You don't show an immediate gift for it, you're no good at it. And I can't do that. That's not my skill. I haven't got the capacity. I haven't got that. You can talk that. You go look at 4-year-old kids. They're everything. They're engaged. They're fully engaged. My great, very good friend Ricardo says, in fact, if we look at children, happy, active children, we actually see what people can be. But in growing out of that, we lose all that. It's the potentiality of what people can be is displayed in small children. Yet somehow we think that's childish. We've got to, you know, narrow ourselves and be abstracted into enormous waste of potential. you've got a brain in your head, you've got more potential interconnections than there are stars in the universe. But what we do with it?
It's interesting that you use shipbuilding as the example before, because now when they do replica building of old ships, they actually can't figure out how they built them.
Yeah.
They can only do it by using modern technology.
Yeah.
And no one is able to figure out how they actually did it without these tools.
The enormous the enormous experiments that have been done to have pyramids built. Yeah? Guys didn't actually have wheels or rollers. They hadn't worked that out yet. So how do they build these pyramids? But oh, we need a forklift. it's interesting. So yeah, it's a very, 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 very spot on point there, Shannon, that you know the abstraction is also then drives us, and that's one thing Marx talks about. That what we do is we end up just wasting human potentiality.
And again, that's what maintains the system as well.
Yep, very true, very true.
Okay.
Look, look at what Harvey and Cleaver have got here, so they pick up any points I've missed. That's the crux of that section that I see. Any questions at this stage?
Well, what you were talking about before, the kind of actualization of the concept, do you mean that as in certainly necessary later time abstract labor?
I mean in terms of abstract labor. Ultimately you would try and search for some sort of actualization of concrete labor. I mean that's the point of socialism. That's finally when we have control over concrete labor and we can democratically control production. But the only kind of thing that we have access to under capitalism is abstract labor. The only kind of thing that we're on the level of consciousness and understanding is abstract labor. The only thing that's kind of live to any kind of possibility is abstract labor under capitalism. I guess I would also add, like, under socialism, all of these machines would be used to liberate us.
Yeah.
But it's the social circumstances under capitalism that we become enslaved to the machine.
Yeah.
So all of it, and this is kind of where all of the machines that we built up, all of the technology and all the stuff that we've learned under capitalism, we can, like, they'll just be, well, you know, you could use the Hegelian alchemy. We just, suddenly the social relations change and all of these things that we were enslaved to suddenly become useful to us to achieve liberation. So that's what my answer to the so what would be. It's like we're still using the machine at an immediate level, to still
Okay, yeah, I just want to be clear on pick this up here, because one thing he's very good at in this chapter is actually pulling out the class contents of these abstractions. So yes, there's the illustrations, the two categories of use, study, and exchange value are not just abstract concepts arrived at by mental reasoning or analytical abstraction. They do not exist only in the passage of the commodity through the exchange process. These two aspects also express the two-sided contradiction characteristic of class relations in capitalism. The view of a commodity as a use value is the perspective of the worker, the working class. The class sees commodities as objects of appropriation and consumption, things to be used to satisfy its needs. Capital sees these same commodities as exchange values, means towards the end of increasing capital. Okay? So this whole thing, so that's actually a very clever, because we're talking this thing where you go to work and doing this concrete thing and at the same time this abstract thing, producing a use and exchange value. And the point of the people actually, you know, living life, working people. The pizza is important because I want to eat it for lunch. The shoes are important because I want to wear them. But for the person who puts you to work, capital, it's totally irrelevant. What's relevant is the simple abstract labor that produces a value that I can then realize in the marketplace to make money, to reinvest, to make more money. So these abstractions actually express also the class perspective, the class contradiction. The direct producer, the worker, is interested in what he produces or other people produce because it's something he or she wants to use in their life. There's a need they want to take, they want to fulfill, it's what they want to do. The person who puts them to work is only interested in those objects as embodiments of simple labour because he or she can exchange them.
Can I, just to bring that into reality?
Yep.
Like, what does that then look like? Like, I suppose, working in, providing counselling. How does that, obviously I don't quite clearly see the value of going in to do my work. One is to the impact that has on the other person with the counselling, but also the money that I take to then buy what I need. How does that role play into creating value for counselling?
Okay. What you do is basically medical. Medical of the head.
Yeah.
Of the spirit, or what you want to call it, okay?
Yeah.
You're basically repairing damaged people. What's the purpose of repairing them?
Yeah, getting back to work.
Getting back to work. In other words, you are maintaining a commodity called labour power.
Yeah.
Those people are useful to capital because they bear within them the capacity to do abstract, simple labour and create value, hence exchange value, hence money. Okay? They are important because in this walking thinking form, they have the capacity to make me money. They contain the commodity labour power. So your job, same as a teacher, same as the nurses, same as the psychologist, same as the doctor, is to maintain and repair. You're the mechanic of the car. You are the mechanic of the car, the repairer of the machine. You are directly involved in producing a commodity, the commodity called labour power.
And I think kind of was then, like, how does it, I suppose what was actually coming to mind then was behind that, how does that determine, because at some point, how much we, when it comes to services we deliver, what programs there are, I mean, not that specifically because I don't really care, but just the extent to which we have the scope to provide services in general, how much we get funded to do this, is somehow playing into that. At some level...
You all know that what you do is not enough.
Yeah.
You all know you could and should do a lot more to help people. You all know the funding isn't there to do it.
Mm.
And that's precisely the point. The funding you get is just enough to get them back on the wage market.
Okay.
It's not about making them better people. It's not about repairing them to function, to full potential. Who cares? It's getting them back on the wage market.
I guess so.
And if that requires a handful of tablets every day,
yeah.
Who cares?
That's not what we've seen in the past. In my experience, someone's been on sensory computer disability payments, but they go back to work and then find out it's too much, I can't actually do this. Sensory you've done full time work, you're obviously capable of doing it, even if it's kind of too stressful, and it's a lot harder for them to get back on
the computer. Right, you go find something else. You're now once again in that system of being abstracted labour. Okay, that you couldn't do. Find something else. You go back to work. You've been fixed.
Which is why people are then facing deportation and get access to service.
Because you've got no value. They have no value.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how cracked up they are in that centre over there.
Mm-hmm.
They have no market value. They have no labour power.
Mm-hmm.
They are not going to get to the labour force. Their human needs, that's pretty minor.
I think it's something along, like it's about getting people assimilated as well, I reckon. Like
into the system to
which is part of,
not cause trouble.
Yeah, which is part of the same thing.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not about actually fixing them, it's getting them to...
There's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of self-help stuff, doesn't it? I think Ray was recently that was saying that a lot of mental health counselling and so on has a very capitalist idea that teach them to just accept the system in the way they are.
Stay busy.
Anger management.
Yeah.
I had a 60 course in counselling years ago with that anger management. And what was very apparent was the guy I was talking to. And with a private relationship, I was playing him myself. he wasn't actually interested in analysing why I felt how I felt. He wasn't actually interested in working out that. It was basically, he had a bunch of techniques to stop you getting angry. Because it was all about functioning within. And actually, he said to me at one stage, you must never use the word should. Why? Because that implies the world should fit you, and why should it? You just say, okay, well, the world's not going to fit you. You've got to fit the world. You have to fit into the world. The world's not going to fit. That's it. You have, it doesn't matter what you think, what you feel, what you've analysed, what you've learned, you have to fit into the world. You have the techniques, or you get medication.
You wouldn't believe the average that it causes into services like ours when somebody refuses to accept that.
Well, I went away and thought about it and analysed it and worked out for myself that given I was living within a capitalist mode of production and all that kind of stuff, I was actually quite justified in feeling angry. The only problem was I took the anger out in the wrong people.
Yeah.
So the issue was to make sure I got back into politics so I could be angry at the right people. So communism for me was therapy. Communism, I went back into it because that was therapy. I could be angry at the right people. At the right targets, not shout at the dog, or my wife, or my kids.
And your therapy was also trying to change the system.
Yeah, that's right, exactly.
Yeah, the causality one, makes me feel like this, and it's like, well, later it doesn't make you feel like that. You
choose to feel like, yeah, in response to that stimulus.
Yeah, it's one of the weird things I get to.
I find it really frustrating, because I'm just thinking, like, fucking so much people like experience like serious depression, like, oh, it's on you to just, you know, deal with it.
You have thoughts about it.
You're so bothered about it. Okay.
Yeah. Alright, I think that's pretty much covered what's in that section. It's only a few pages, but it's some important concepts there. Anything else you want to bring up at this point about that? It's this chapter, we do it slowly because it is abstract. There's a lot of stuff to get your head around, even though it's in very short form. It speeds up after chapter one, but we've got the building blocks in place. We've really got to get these building blocks in place. And I want to keep stressing, we're dealing with an analytical account, and Marx is starting with the one thing which contains the entirety of the capitalist system in itself. Virgil Ullmann, who writes about dialectics, talks about lots of internal relations. The object in the dialectical system is to find a monad, a thing, where all the contradictions are contained in microcosm. And Marx finds that in the commodity. And that's wasting work effort. You know, why are we worrying about the clothes, the legs from linen and piles of jute, stuff like that? Because in that, we're already finding all these contradictions. Practical labour, simple labour, use value, exchange value. They're all embedded in there. And once we have those, we can then use that to build up a picture of a social system. And that's why he starts at this point. However difficult it might seem to us with our very heavily empirically trained and inductively trained reasoning. So as much as anything else in this book, you're learning to think differently. So it's as much as anything else, this book is teaching you to think about things differently as well as how to analyse it. And those of us who are, you know, involved in this movement, we often say, well, really at the end of the day, Marxism is not actually about a bundle of doctrines, Marx's conclusions, that's it. It's actually about a method. It's learning how to use the method. Everything he says practically could well be wrong. It doesn't matter. If we have the method, you say, right, let's go back and analyse our world afresh with the same method and see what we come up with. Mm. We've learned to think outside the box. We've learned to think critically. We've learned not to buy into the neo-SLD. Or the very simple deductions, and actually inductions people make. Set of data, oh, that's obviously this. No. That's still very superficial. The philosophers write about dialectics. Marx doesn't do it too much, but certainly Hegel does. Other people have written about Marx, like Kossuth and so on like that, to talk about abstract and concrete. And one of the interesting things, the dialectical method, is what they call concrete is not real. What they call concrete is the mistaken conclusions we make superficially about things. what they call abstract is in fact the real. It is the abstract that tells you how things really work. You have to go, there's a Czech philosopher called Karel Kosek who wrote a brilliant book on this back in the 60s, Dialectics of the Concrete. And he says, we look at the world as though we have a bunch of observations. But none of those observations are neutral or value-free. They're really embedded in a whole bunch of values and theories and ideas and so on like that. Those observations only start to make sense when we tear them out of the everyday world of association. We have to deconstruct them, to use a trendy term from Bourdieu?
No, it's Derrida.
Derrida, I'm not going to be a French bastard, yeah, whatever. We have to deconstruct what we see as the obvious. And then from there we've got to work out what is the abstraction behind it. And that abstraction will start to tell us what really is going on in the world, not the actual things we see. Once we have the abstraction, we can then come back and re-describe what's going on concretely. Double movement. And the normal analytical techniques we learn from day one of school, induction and deduction, are nowhere near adequate to cover this process. Would you agree? You're the philosopher?
Yeah, definitely. Formal logic is what is mind and immediacy.
Yeah.
It's all immediate.
Yeah.
And
it's superficial.
We're all taught to be empiricists, and we're all taught to say that this red patch here, we're told that that is concrete.
Mm.
But really, that is the most abstract thing you could say.
Yeah.
The big upshot of Marx and Hegel is to say that everything is mediated, and only once you've got tarried with the negative and gone through the different mediations, only then will you reach the critical.
Yeah, you're not talking philosophy. So I want to know, I was on the right track.
This is what I'm trying to do. I actually
kind of went back over some Hegel stuff just to get the sound of it.
Working our way through this, you'll start to build your method. Okay? Fantastic. Okay, next fortnight is the first week of school holidays. That's not a problem from our point of view because I'm not going away until the second week. So I am in Perth. I'm just not sure Jennifer has booked. She often books up a lot of things in this holiday period for us to do with the family.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure if it's been booked for that evening or not. For tomorrow we'll assume there isn't and plan to be meeting as normal. If there is a problem, I'll put it up on the page, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But what we'll be looking at then is the third section of chapter one.
I'm hanging out for section four. Section four is the best grade.
Yeah, yeah. Value form or exchange value. So section, we talk a lot more about exchange value and so on. And it gets a little bit accountancy like, but it's not hard.
Going to make us impatient
there. Section three, that's relative and equivalent, right?
Okay, so you work your way through that. Then, of course, Harvey's discussion of that. And Harvey gets quite disparaging every time Marx gets arithmetic. He says, oh, he's put his accountant's hat back on. David's not very good at numbers. That runs in Harvey from page 30. No, that's section 4.
Commodity fetishism, I was like shown that seems to like joke about it as like a Freudian joke. Oh yeah, the commodity fetish.
Patience.
I think they're like Marx.
Yeah, yep, long before Freud, yeah.
I think of the Marx, like, when he was doing like passing by red phone and I didn't get it,
okay.
But I think I kind of understood it more than I can see.
Yep. Okay, 30 to 37. And there's the last chapter in the Cleveland book. So it's chapter 5. Okay? Both the commentaries and that. And we'll say, assume we as per normal, unless something is happening, we'll let you know.
Okay?
But I am in Perth that week, I know that, so I'm not going away from following you.
Sure. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
No, my pleasure. You're all getting something out of this? It's not too didactic, not too school-like.
Yeah.
not too basic.
I think it gives some really good context to some of the driest bits of the book.
Mm.
I think it's important to have this kind of discussion.
As long as I'm doing my job.
No, you definitely are.
I think starting from the back is a really good move, because it does give you a sense of feel for what's going on.
Yeah. That question, how does it happen, has been answered.
Yeah.
In a sense. Because otherwise that's always hanging over here. How does it actually happen? How does this happen? That's always getting in the way.
Mm.
You've still got, that's been done. We know how it happens.
It's just actually a lot. It's
One of the really cool things about reading the first chapters of the book is that there's some of the most hated sections, because Althusser hated it, and so did Stalin.
Yes, in 1944, when they reissued Capital in the Soviet Union, after quite a 20-year gap, it hadn't been republished since after the revolution, and they reissued it in the Russian translation. Chapter 1 was left out.
Is that because they were still quite conservative state capitalists?
Well, basically, there's the articles from 1944-45, an American Economic Review, precisely about this, written by Leonid Donayevskaya, the humanist, and a couple of other people. And they're basically saying, what the Soviets are doing, what Stalin is doing, is hiding that fact that commodity production still continues under their so-called socialist system.
Mm.
They are hiding the fact that they are still doing the same thing.
Stalin
said he was a socialist. So that was taken out of...
You must take the Stalin's word for the...
Good old Uncle Joe and a socialist talk.
I had someone on Facebook saying, socialism will always be bureaucratic and so on.
Does anyone else want coffee?
I'll have one, thanks.
Cool.
And we must, we can't deny that the Stalin himself admitted he was a socialist. So, he must be one if he said so.
Especially if he's admitted it.
No one would ever lie or get things wrong.
Or just be objectively wrong about what they think.
Especially Joseph Stalin. I find it weird, people who have, Islam teachers, violence.
I'm going to quickly recommend two books to you. They actually pertain to Capital, but are very worthwhile reading overall. I'm not going to write the title down or whatever, that one. Peter Gillis, Marx's Concept of the Alternative to Capital. Pardon? This one, it's Haymarket Press, it's part of the Historical Materialism series, came out a few years ago. I'm 100% sure there's a copy floating around somewhere on the internet in PDF version. You'll be able to find it. I'm pretty sure if you dig around a bit of searching, you'll turn it up somewhere in some pirate site or whatever else, okay?
Let's post them up.
I can. That's well worth reading, that's what I'm talking about. He goes through all of Marx's writings and pulls out everything he says and works out the implications for an alternative society. What Marx is talking about is a different kind of society. There's a big chapter there on Capital and so on like that. This has just been published by Verso. My copy arrived yesterday. Jason Moore is a very good friend of mine. I've enjoyed his hospitality in America and we've corresponded for years. This is brilliant. I've read the introduction so far. It's going to be an absolutely brilliant book. I read his PhD thesis, but he's writing it. I read some of the chapters now. I've read a few drafts of this before. But this is one of the really powerful things about this book is he actually tackles what he calls the problem of green arithmetic. The sort of idea we have that the world comprises capital S society, capital M nature. They are quite separate. And what society, people do is stuff of nature. And then it collapses. So you get this apocalyptic, end of the world, Anthropocene kind of thinking that is flying around most so-called left or green currents nowadays. And he goes right back into market and metabolism. We have to understand social systems as an ecology.
Yeah, naturalistically, yeah.
As an ecology, in which the things flow together, okay, work together. and he's got some interesting ideas there going beyond Marx in a couple of areas and back and so on like that, just introduction around. So I would strongly, this one you won't find, it's only just come out, you won't find it in PDF. However, Verso, the publishers, do offer an electronic copy. So if one person were to buy an electronic copy, you could immediately ship. It has your name on it when you buy it, so it's technically, you know, it gets on the internet, they know it's possibly you. But if you still, you put it shared privately among people. Because they do sell PDF or EPUB versions of them, of e-books. Okay? But definitely, definitely strongly, I'm going to tell David to put this into the Radical Book Club. This definitely needs to be read by people. Because it's going to provide an answer, or part of the answer to this whole apocalyptic Anthropocene kind of thing that is so characteristic of modern green thinking. We're all going to die in two generations and so on like that. You need not. And it's not necessarily like that. There's a mistake in how we understand the world. This idea that, you get the deep greens and we have to go back to doing Stone Age hunter gatherers. That's the only solution to destroy civilization.
I do have appreciation of the Return to the Wild crew. I've got.
Oh, yeah,
they're not on my.
There are times when I know, but it's a classic case of reduction. All human social systems have messed with the environment. Well, environments have changed people as well, but forget that. Therefore, all social systems are bad, therefore, we've got to have none.
Yeah.
It's that classic, very simple inductive argument without getting into the proper dialectic of it.
I feel like the only person I know who kind of makes that argument, I feel like it's always just made a bit kind of like to the...
Right.
Yeah. I don't want to say it. I feel like his argument is just like kind of being like deliberately like, isn't it crazy? Like, I'm going a step further and all those other anarchists and completely removing all the system.
Yeah, right. So I just highly recommend. I strongly recommend like those books to me.
Very good to use your man.